My name is William Jefferson Black. I'm the publisher of Transaction Advisors and the host of our M&A Methods interview series. Welcome to the latest edition. And pleased to host our interview discussion today with Tom McGee from RPM International. RPM International is a public company based outside of Cleveland, Ohio. It has been involved in more than 150 acquisitions over the last 20 years. So Tom's got a variety of war stories and experiences that he'll be able to draw from and add some perspective to our conversation today.
Absolutely. Well, RPM is divided into a number of divisions. There's a consumer part of the business that has well-known brands like Rust-Oleum and DAP that you could find at a big box store, and everyone has a little bit extra of it in their garage somewhere. And so those are great legacy brands that have been in the RPM family for 20 years plus. Just fantastic businesses. And then we have an industrial segment that are, it's a series of B2B businesses, also fantastic businesses, but you wouldn't see them on the shelves of retail stores. Carboline is an example, doing coatings on oil and gas pipelines, all sorts of specialty applications. Then we have a third group, which is where I'm involved in our M&A efforts, which is the specialty products group. So this is a constellation of smaller, more entrepreneurial businesses that are best run with the lightest touch possible within the context of a publicly traded group. And these are eight businesses that have really, really interesting defined niches and coatings defined perhaps more broadly than you would think a traditional coatings company would be.
Well, let's talk about the M&A process has been pretty significant for RPM. It's been obviously a story of organic growth, right, as well as inorganic growth, 150 deals. And reflecting back, let's use the last decade as a lens for a minute. The business has outperformed the S&P 500 index by some 70%. How much of that is attributed to the M&A and the inorganic growth driver?
It's quite important. The reality is many of our markets are mature. And the business grew for many, many years organically. And then really there was a shift, a paradigm shift at RPM, actually more than 20 years ago, where they realized that in order to keep growing the business, they just had to define it a little bit more broadly. And the idea was to find great businesses that already had great teams that knew their niches and to expand into those tangential areas by acquisition. And so that's what RPM became very good at doing over the years.
And tell me about, again, let's keep with the 10-year theme. So as you reflect back, let's just call it the last decade, what's changed as a corporate development officer? And I don't mean specifically at RPM per se, but how has the role changed? What about the expectations for a corporate development officer?
Yeah, I think there was always an element where the corporate development was part of the strategy of the group. That's the whole idea of having a corporate development team, because they understand more than just the transactional what, but the strategic why you're doing those things. That's always been the case. I think what's perhaps changed a little bit over the years has been the quantitative side of it and the valuation modeling. That's probably more robust now than it was historically. So at the end of the day, it's still based on relationships and a fair price to both buyers and sellers, but I certainly have seen that change with more sophisticated valuation modeling techniques.
On that level, is that something that you like to always do in-house? Is it something that you always like to outsource? Or how do you think about modeling and valuation analysis?
Good question. The core of the modeling is in-house because we feel it's an expertise we have to have in-house. However, we do at RPM rely on outside advisors specialized in transaction advisory work to help us pressure test our models and certainly to review the financials that we uncover during our due diligence to update our model accordingly.
So first pass is that you do your model and then use an outside party to test the bias and the stress against that model. Is that right?
That's essentially right, because obviously in the course of due diligence, we've made some initial assumptions on our valuation model, and that due diligence partner is going to uncover some good news, some bad news, right? And then we're also going to get more involved in the detail of what we're buying into, and so we're going to have more visibility into the synergies. And so there is certainly a dynamic of updating that valuation model.
Right, and the synergy view is really where you draw on your internal team to understand?
That's absolutely right.
Well, and tell us, if you would, about your process and your method of building relationships? Do you have any techniques or methods that you like to use? For example, I heard someone once reference that they always wanted the first meeting to be over dinner, not at the office, because it set a different fundamental tone to the relationship. And so as they were cultivating privately held business owners, that was part of their formula. Do you have a secret sauce that you bring to build those relationships?
We have a few different secret sauces that have worked over the years because we've been at it for so long. So we have a network of buy-side brokers who help introduce us to appropriate opportunities. And really, they're not involved in the due diligence, but what they're doing is they're getting me in the door at the right level, at the ownership level. Sure. And frequently, the president of the business operationally may not be the owner. We need to make sure that we're talking with the decision maker and then able to have that decision. And again, we want to do that early. So we want to make sure that, again, we're in advance, even sometimes it's years in advance of when an owner will consider a sale decision. So the broker angle does work well for us.
And could you put some perspective around this process? Are you, out of 100 books that you might see or opportunities that you might screen, what does that funnel tend to look like over the past decade? Do you, you know, is it 5% get into serious negotiations and 1% close? Or what is that ratio to look like?
Yeah, you know, just anecdotally, I have a feeling that it's obviously a very low percentage. Again, RPM, because of its size and its stature in the coatings industry, will tend to get books that are relevant to our business because they know if it's a coating business, we'll get it. What we won't get, though, we won't get the breadth of opportunities because perhaps people won't think of us outside of that box of coatings, when in fact we have some really interesting businesses in our portfolio, like, for example, edible food coatings. And so a company in the food business may not think, or a banker may not think of giving RPM a book because they look at us as a Rust-Oleum company. So the deals we get tend to be very focused on traditional coatings businesses. And again, by definition, it's an auction process. And so therefore, that's going to be somewhat less interesting to us because we traditionally have done less integration on the back end of deals. So therefore, in an auction environment, if the synergy is going to make the economics of the deal, that's a tougher pond for us to fish in.
Now, as far as this pipeline deal flow and idea generation process works, would you say that getting the business owners involved in that process is an effective method one might consider? Or in contrast, because they lack a sophistication in the corporate development process, are they clumsy actors in trying to cultivate new and fresh deal flow ideas? How do you juggle that mix, or how do you think one might think about that consideration of getting those business, you know, those business unit leaders empowered to think about their own deals?
The reality is the best resource that I have to open up new deal flow are the current company presidents within my group. Right? My job is, really, I'm working for them to help them grow their business in an inorganic way. And so at RPM, we have an annual meeting called Growth Strategy and Connections. And all the businesses come and they present what they want to do with their businesses over the next 5 years. And obviously, acquisitions is something that is part of that process. So that gives me some runway to understand what the priorities of the businesses are. And then usually these business presidents have great contacts within their respective industries, and they can open up a door for me.
Thank you to our underwriter, Intralinks. From IPOs to spin-offs, restructurings, and mergers and acquisitions, Intralinks provides a best-in-class platform for your next transaction. So when you're then getting engaged in a deal cycle, there's clearly a standard due diligence list that you work from.
Yes.
But are there any unusual, special Tom items that are on the list that you've used and you found this is a really clever and an alternative method of diligencing an element of a business?
I don't know of a formal process, but I'll tell you what's really important for us is that we can rely on others to go in and do a diligence assessment of the financials. But what we really need to do is understand if it's a cultural fit. That's the secret sauce. But we don't have a formal assessment of that, so I have to say that it's still gut.
Sure.
But even though it's gut, it's very important.
It's important.
And I think the way a seller negotiates is the way a seller will be when they're part of our group. And so if it's an unpleasant process on the front end and it feels transactional on the front end, and we're not talking about building the cathedral, and we're talking about the last dollar, right, then most likely that's going to be a frustrating experience if they become part of our organization. Another red flag is if you see a leader of an organization who has not developed a strong team around them. So if it's a team of one, that's really, really risky, because if that one person departs for whatever reason, you're not buying a legacy.
And to that, do you feel earnouts are a nice safety mechanism for that concern of having the right person or the right fit? Or have you found those to be, again, more ineffective than effective?
They're wonderful in principle and terrible in practice. There's an accounting complexity that gets brought into things with an earnout, accounting for an earnout appropriately, and many of the businesses that we're looking at, our bread and butter, tend to be smaller deals. So we're dealing with a business that's maybe doing $50 million in sales or even smaller, $20 million in sales. It's great to have that earnout, but in the end of the day, it's a lot of work, and we generally, while we discuss it as a way to bridge a value gap, it's rarely been an effective tool for us.
Yeah, it's interesting. So you really got to get it right on the front end, and you really got to get the culture piece to sit in balance with the economic opportunity. And how much do you think about within that mix then, if we now understand a little better about what's been effective in the way you balance these considerations, how about the macro considerations, materially or not? So, where we are in the economic cycle, where we are with a rising interest rate or cost of capital. Small items, big items, how do you like to think about those in the mix in addition to your diligence and your culture considerations?
Certainly they all need to be weighed and considered, because the reality is that construction products can be a cyclical business. So we have to think where we are in the cycle. Since we're not traders of businesses and we're not planning an exit with a certain timing, we have the luxury in a sense to be a little bit less transactional in our approach to the business cycle, because again, we're long-term buy and hold investors. But certainly it's important. The other thing that's important is to do market due diligence, not just financial due diligence. So we don't want to be lulled into believing that we know everything about coatings. Every business has its own customer base and its own niche. So I'll frequently retain a subject matter expert during the diligence process to write a report on the industry to validate our own assumptions about what's going on.
And what type of information is in a report like that? What do you like to look for there?
Well, if we're really lucky, there might be an off-the-shelf market research report on that topic. But generally speaking, those will be templates, and they'll be old and not our exact niche. So what we'll try to do is purchase an off-the-shelf report, then give that to a consultant as a reference document, and then give them our specific unique questions, and then have them discreetly call to distributors of the business, industry associations, and validate some of the things that we've been told about what that market really looks like. It's most specifically, who's competing based on price versus value? And are there any disruptive technologies that may be right around the corner that we can't see as an outsider? So that's been helpful.
Are you able to find where there's really a commodity environment, price competitive environment? Is that uncovered often through that type of diligence?
It can be. So for example, we might have, we might be using an online data room, an Intralinks, something like that, and then there'll be the intellectual property loaded up in the data room. Well, what's the life remaining in those patents? So if we see that there's a small life remaining in those patents, we really have to dig deeper to understand the competitive dynamic and how much the expiration of those patents might materially impact the business.
Anything, you do deals all over the world, you see anything clever coming from Europe? Do you see anything interesting, in Asia or other markets as far as deal structuring goes? And we did a session on the lockbox closing mechanism and reverse due diligence, and we're always on the lookout for what's interesting and what's happening in cross-border deals. Have you noticed anything interesting of late?
The only thing that I see also merging over here or bleeding over here would be the seller quality of earnings reports. The smart sellers have done it. Now, frequently you'll see that when there's more of an auction environment,
right,
and again, what we're trying to do is specifically avoid auctions, so I may see it a bit less,
sure,
but a savvy business owner who is planning on a transition, whether it would be an auction or a one-on-one dialogue with us, would be very smart to do that, because they'll find the rocks before all the water goes down in the harbor.
Right. And as part of that process that you're looking for, assurance within the deal terms that they're representing and warranting the diligence? Or is it really that they've used that to clean up and improve the business in advance of a sale or a transition? Is it related to the deal terms, or is it that it's the care with which they're stewards of the business and making sure it's a clean acquisition?
I think it's the latter. I think that, at least that's been my experience, particularly on the lower end of the business size that we're looking at, we will find a business that's really quite attractive. We'll have an initial dialogue, but there's something wrong with the business, or the business needs to be improved, and we think it can be a fine business. It's just not yet there. And so a seller to do that internal assessment, even with some of our advice, but with their independent advice, that can prepare the business for a sale in a few years' time.
Sure. Now let's try and look out 10 years. Okay. I'm enjoying this 10-year horizon. Now we're looking forward 10 years.
Yeah.
What do you expect if we sat down here again? We would be talking about what's going to change? What's going to be different? What's going to be new? What should we be watching?
It's interesting. Well, I think as far as what won't change, I mean, clearly there's going to be a lot of technological disruption. The world's going to keep getting smaller. E-commerce, social media, all those trends will just accelerate. But at the end of the day, no business owner sells their business over the phone. So what's not going to change is you have to get on a plane, and then you have to go visit someone's business and take a plant tour and go to lunch and understand what they're trying to accomplish and build that upfront relationship that doesn't feel transactional, because it's not.
Right?
There's a journey they're on. There's a journey RPM is on. We want to just be open to the possibilities so that they know who we are. So that's not going to change. As far as the process of doing due diligence and collaborating in online spaces and online data rooms, or even CRM-related business development tools that allow you to be more methodical as you go through the haystack for needles, those will all get better. But at the end of the day, I'll probably still be in a plane seat.
Well, thank you so much for spending some time and telling us some good war stories and lessons learned. Really appreciate it.
It's a pleasure, William. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. Thanks again to our underwriter, Intralinks, the leading virtual data room provider who supports 99% of the Fortune 1000 companies. From deal preparation, diligence, right through to closing. Find out more at intralinks.com.